Thanks, Kenneth. My name is Keith Dunn. I'm the Senior Vice President for Academic Affairs and Dean of the College at Millsaps. It's my distinct pleasure to welcome you here to the 2017 Rabbi Nussbaum Lecture Series. This follows the Rabbi Nussbaum Awards ceremony last night for Civil Justice Awards. And I'd like to take just a minute to recognize our award winners from last night. Jerry Mitchell, Dr. John Peoples, George W. Rogers Jr., and Lamis El-sadek. Did I get it?
Excellent.
And I'll point you to your program to read the description of some of the remarkable things that our awardees accomplished during their lifetimes. It's a great pleasure. Besides providing a transformational educational experience for our students, which is our primary purpose, the Rabbi Nussbaum Awards and Lecture Series is one of the best things that Millsaps does. We're very proud to be associated with this, very thankful that Dr. Bauer chose to partner with Millsaps and to provide the resources and the inspiration for this significant event every year. Dr. Bauer has been a real stalwart in promoting civil justice and preserving and promoting Rabbi Perry Nussbaum's accomplishments and his character. And for those of you who have not had a chance to go to the awards ceremony and hear Dr. Bauer talk about Rabbi Nussbaum, I want to read just a paragraph or so from the introduction to remind you of the extraordinary things that he brought to this community. Rabbi Nussbaum took the pulpit at Beth Israel Congregation in Jackson in 1954. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I do want to point out that in 1964, he helped found the Committee of Concern, an interracial group of ministers that sought to raise money to rebuild bombed or burned churches. On September 18, 1967, Nussbaum's own house of worship was bombed by local Ku Klux Klan members. 2 months later, the same group bombed Nussbaum's home. A man of extraordinary character and courage, we're proud to be part of helping his legacy live on. Dr. Bauer, we'd like to thank you for this opportunity. It's now my distinct pleasure to introduce our speaker this year. Lamis El-sadek graduated from Millsaps in 2011 with a Bachelor of Science and two majors, one in biology and one as a self-designed major in international health and economics. If these two ambitious endeavors were not enough, she also completed a minor in faith and work. At Millsaps, Lamis founded and directed Throw What You Know, a grassroots community project designed to help young people throw away religious stereotypes by engaging them in interfaith discussions and service projects promoting interfaith collaboration. After Millsaps, she entered the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, where she earned a Master's of Health Science in Social Factors of Health and certification in Health Disparities and Health Inequality. While at Johns Hopkins, Lamis was selected to be a Susan G. Komen Disparities Research Fellow, allowing her to travel to Cairo, Egypt, where she conducted research on health disparities involving low or no income women with breast cancer. As an Albert Schweitzer Fellow, she trained Baltimore high school students to serve as peer educators in preventing dating and domestic violence. Lamis returned to Mississippi as an epidemiologist and program and policy evaluator at the Mississippi State Department of Health. She was involved in numerous chronic disease-associated activities, including the 2015 and 2016 Diabetes Action Plan, the Governor's Task Force on Health, Disease, and Stroke Prevention, Diabetes Coalition of Mississippi, and the Mississippi State Department of Health Office of Preventative Health Statewide Empowering Communities Conference. As an interfaith activist, Lamis successfully advocated for an interfaith prayer space so that Muslim employees of MSDH could perform their mandatory 5 daily prayers during the workday. Lamis is currently a Gates Millennium Scholar at the Harvard University T.H. Chan School of Public Health, where she is a candidate for the doctorate in public health. She is widely published, author, and blogs for the Huffington Post on education, public health, social justice, and interfaith topics. Whether she is fighting oppression based on race or religion, or working to end health inequities through research, policy, and programming, Lamise plans to dedicate her life to leading social change. It gives me great pleasure to present this Lifetime Achievement Award at the ripe old age of 20. No. It had to be a Lifetime Achievement, but it is not a Lifetime Achievement. No, it gives me great pleasure to introduce the 2017 recipient of the Rabbi Perry Nussbaum Award as an emerging leader in civil justice, Lamise El-sadek.
I feel like my entire life is being evaluated right now. The people who hired me are here, my family's here, my old professors are here, my friends are here, so no pressure. So I'm trying to get through a lot today, so I'm going to try to speak fast, but somebody just shot at me if I'm speaking too fast. I'm just going to give a quick overview of what health is, what health equity and the social determinants of health are, so that we're all on the same page. I'm going to define embodiment and give you some examples of what we mean in Mississippi when we talk about embodiment, discuss some current challenges or threats to the Mississippi public health system, summarize the importance of public health surveillance and data collection, and then discuss a few ideas of where we can go from here. So the Health Equity Bible, or Quran, or Torah, or whatever your faith means. So health, according to the World Health Organization, is a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. And so when we talk about health inequality, it can refer to a difference, any health difference. There it is. It can refer to any health difference between groups of people. And it doesn't, and health inequality may not be avoidable. So for example, baby boys tend to weigh more than baby girls. And that's not something that we can do anything about. Whereas health disparity refers to the health difference that's closely linked with political, social, or economic disadvantage. So for example, babies born to black mothers have a higher risk of not surviving to their first birthday in comparison to babies born to white mothers. And we can do something about health disparity, but health equity or health justice refers to the public health aspiration that we will provide this justice for all people and give all people the resources that they need to live the healthiest life they can. So, a number of people in the public health world in this audience have seen this image. And it illustrates, the images help illustrate the difference between health inequality and equity. In the first image, everyone benefits from the same number of crates. Everyone is treated exactly the same. But in the process, we advantage the already tall guy and disadvantage the shortest kid. And moreover, the tall guy has an even more elevated view of the game, making it harder for anyone behind him to see the game, while the shorter kid still struggles. In the second image, everyone is given however many number of crates that that group needs to see the game. That's what health equity is about, and that's what public health professionals are attempting to do every single day. Not necessarily give every population the same level of resources, but give every population an adequate and appropriate level of resources to thrive in life. But of course, thanks to woke people across the nation, this illustration was amended even further, and the necessity of defense in real life, whether defense has to exist, period, whether it should be wood panels or barbed wire, or whether it's an actual fence, wall, or whether it's a metaphoric fence, check the box, redlining, or discriminatory zoning, it's worth our time to more deeply understand the purpose and designs of fences. So I don't want to belabor this point, but I just wanted you to note to yourself what instincts you may feel when you look at this image. And if you feel the same about this image as you did the previous image, are you more at ease with this image because maybe it's a picket fence instead of a wooden fence? Or is it because the fans are white? Or do you even feel differently about the two images? But again, this is just food for reflection. So moving on, I wanted to quickly debrief on my particular passion within the field of public health, and that refers to the social determinants of health. This describes the conditions under which people are born, grow, live, pray, and work and age. These circumstances are shaped by the distribution of money, power, and resources at global, national, and local levels. A recent meta-analysis of nearly 50 studies by a Harvard professor, Sandra Galeo, found that only 20 to 30% of deaths are due to genetics. And up to 60 to 70% of deaths, depending on how you understand individual behaviors, are attributed to social factors. I say this to emphasize the importance of studying and understanding social determinants of health and health equity. So Healthy People 2020 is a task force of public health experts nationwide who set goals for the nation. They categorize the social determinants of health into these five categories, which you can, no need for me to talk them out. But I'll give a description of how social determinants of health can systematically contribute to multi-generational health impacts. In the US, a child born to parents without a high school education is more likely to live in a neighborhood that's unsafe, has dilapidated housing, and maybe has exposed garbage litter, which is relevant for its associated asthmatic, toxic, or environmental effects. These neighborhoods are also less likely to have sidewalks, parks or playgrounds, or a library. Racial and ethnic minority communities are more likely than their white counterparts to live in these communities of concentrated poverty, and there's growing evidence demonstrating that the stress associated with living under these circumstances contributes to what we call allostatic bloating, or the wear and tear on the body's nervous system, which contribute to what we call bad behavior, impulsive behavior, attention deficit in schools. So moving on, now that we have this overview of why we see differences in health outcomes according to population, I want to discuss this notion of embodiment. Embodiment is a term conceptualized by probably the world's leading pioneering social epidemiologist, Dr. Nancy Krieger. Embodiment recognizes that humans are simultaneously social beings and biological organisms. So the notion of embodiment advances two claims. One, that our bodies literally, that our bodies tell these stories about the conditions of our existence, and these stories can't be studied or divorced from these conditions. Two, bodies tell stories that people cannot or will not tell, either because they are unable, forbidden, choose not to, or simply aren't aware. Although it's well recognized that there is no actual gene that determines race, society has categorized us in a way where some groups of people who experience disease, suffering, and death at differential rates according to their socially constructed race. So that makes race important. In other words, even though our race often does not, but sometimes does, innately predispose us to disease, our race becomes biology in the sense that it becomes a social exposure to biological As an example, Dr. Krieger did a study where she compared black infant mortality rates both prior and subsequent to the legal desegregation of the states. In this study, she found that within 10 years, indeed, black infant mortality rates had declined. But still, Jim Crow remains with us today as embodied history, since every person in the US before 1965 was born when Jim Crow was the law of the land in 21 states. So everyone born during this period experienced birth conditions that not only affect their adult health outcomes today and their chances of mortality today, but they also pass that on to their children. So Jim Crow will continue to be embodied in generations to come. As a couple of other examples where we biologically embody our society, consider this study of Dr. Kawachi, where he studied the diabetes and hypertension prevalence among West Africans and African communities originating in the Caribbean populations, and found these prevalences to be lower than those among Black Americans and Black Brits. As another example, Professor Kawachi studied the birth weight of infants who were born in Africa, in certain African nations, and they were very similar to the infant birth weights among white babies here in the U.S. But you take Black infant birth weight and you shift that curve, you shift the entire curve left. So the population as a whole has a lower birth weight. And so obviously something is happening within the U.S. context that's contributing to this birth difference. And then as a final example, if you just look at our life expectancy here, the U.S. has a life expectancy of about 79 years. Mississippi as a whole has a life expectancy of 75. So we already see a disparity between Mississippi and the rest of the nation. But then if you analyze it even further, you see that white Mississippians are living longer than Black Mississippians within the same context. And then just to give a few more Mississippi-specific examples of this embodiment, here you look at one of the very few diseases where white Mississippians actually do worse than Black Mississippians, and that's according to coronary heart disease. And from 2011 through 2015, every single year, more white adult Mississippians have reported that they have issues with coronary heart disease in comparison to their Black counterparts. But if you look at mortality, Blacks are dying at higher rates than whites for this disease. So even though a fewer proportion of Blacks report heart disease, more Blacks die. This inequity leads us to ask why. Why do people seek emergency care instead of primary care? Where do whites versus Blacks live? How close do they live to these provider facilities? Can they afford the costs? Are they insured? What type of jobs do they occupy? How supportive are their jobs of seeking care? Is their wage and salary even sufficient for them to seek care? And according to every single question, we see that even though Blacks carry the advantage in or not carrying the disease, their social context still takes ownership over their bodies, ultimately leading to a greater risk of death. We see a similar trend if you look at stroke prevalence. Here we see that Black and white Mississippians have nearly the exact same, report the exact same level of stroke. And note also that both groups are significantly higher than the national average. But at least we suffer together. But if you look at mortality rate, again, Blacks leave the white population and die at higher rates in comparison to their white counterparts. And as a final example, if we look at Mississippi's diabetes prevalence, we see a similar trend. Blacks report diabetes exists in a greater proportion of Blacks than it does in whites, and Mississippi as a whole suffers from diabetes in greater proportion to the nation. But if you look at the mortality rate, white adult Mississippi and then the nation are almost the exact same, are dying from diabetes at almost the exact same rate. And Blacks are on a whole nother page. And it asks us again, if this is a controllable disease that doesn't have anything to do with innate or inherent qualities, then what is going on around these communities that are contributing to faster deaths and shorter lives? So as a final illustration to impart and hopefully pound in how this idea of how race and racism become embodied within us, or manifestations of social exposure, I'd like to share a powerful short video segment by one of my role models, Dr. Kamara Jones, a social epidemiologist physician, and she's the current president of the American Public Health Association. And this past year, she made racism the official American Public Health Association campaign. And she's known for her allegories on health, on race and racism. And she gives the same allegories over and over at every conference that you go to. And we ask her, you know, where are the new allegories? And she says, well, I'm gonna keep saying them until you learn to say them yourself. But, you know, there's YouTube, so. So I may need help. Oh, you have it open, right? Yep, perfect.
My third story, Levels of Racism, A Gardener's Tale, comes from my experience when my husband and I, newlywed, bought our first freestanding house with a big wraparound porch with flower boxes all along the porch. Now, when we went to plant our marigold seeds, we saw some of the boxes had dirt in them and some of the boxes were empty. So my husband dutifully goes to the garden store and he's hauling big old bags of potting soil, and we fill up the empty boxes and we put equal numbers of seeds in all of the boxes. And we water all of the boxes, and I'm not the gardener, so I sit back just going to enjoy. And 3 weeks later, I walk out of my front door and I stopped in my tracks, because it looked to me like we had planted completely different species in some of the boxes versus others. In some of the boxes, there were full of plants, tall and vigorous looking plants, and other boxes just had a few plants in them and they were scrawny and scraggly. And then I realized what had happened. That potting soil was rich, fertile soil, so that in the potting soil, every single seed had sprouted, with a strong seed growing very tall and vigorous, but even the weak seed making it to a middling height. But in that old soil, that poor rocky soil that we had found there, the weak seed had died. And even the strong seed had to struggle to make it halfway up. And if you guys garden, well, maybe you've composted half of your garden and you've seen the same thing. This image is about the importance of the soil, the importance of the environment. And I'm gonna make it a story about racism. But before I do that, I want to talk to you just a little bit more about racism, because in the story, I'm gonna illustrate three different levels of racism: institutionalized, personally mediated, and internalized. And so, you know, sometimes I have an hour to talk about these things. I don't today, but I'm just gonna quickly define each of them, make some important points, and then share the story. Institutionalized racism, what is it? It is that system that results in differential access to the goods, services, and opportunities of society by race. This is the kind of racism that doesn't require an identifiable perpetrator. This is the kind of racism that's been institutionalized in our laws and our norms, and actually often shows up as inherited disadvantage. These are some examples of how it can impact you. Sometimes people look at my top bullet of housing, education, employment, and wealth, and they ask, isn't that social class? Why do you have this on a slide about racism? To which I respond, it doesn't just so happen that people of color in this country are overrepresented in poverty, while white people in this country are overrepresented in wealth. That's not just a happenstance. But for each marginalized, oppressed, stigmatized group, there's been some initial historical injustice. So for American Indians, for example, it was the taking of the land and the genocide, and then the moving of the survivors to the reservations. For people of African descent, it was the kidnapping of West African people, and then our importation across the Atlantic with tremendous loss of life in the Middle Passage. And then for the survivors, what I describe as the coerced usury of our unpaid labor for centuries to build this country. But then people stop me there and they say, well, you know what, Dr. Jones, you're talking about slavery. But the enslaved people were emancipated by 1865, and that's fully 149 years ago now. So all else being equal, don't you think the impacts of slavery would have washed out by now? But the key phrase there is all else being equal. And all else has not been equal since 1865, and all else still is not equal today. And there are still what I describe as contemporary, present-day structural factors that are perpetuating the initial historical insult. And so when people ask me, am I talking about racism or social class, I say that institutionalized racism explains why we even see an association between social class and race in this country. Before I get off of this, I need to also say that institutionalized racism can be through acts of doing as well as acts of not doing, and often shows up as inaction in the face of need. The second level of racism, personally mediated racism, I define as differential assumptions about the abilities, motives, and intents of others by race, and then differential actions based on those assumptions. So here now we're talking about what most people think of when they hear the word racism. Somebody did something to somebody. It includes the prejudice and the discrimination, lots of ways that it can impact your health and your whole well-being. And like institutionalized racism, it can be through acts of doing as well as acts of not doing, but even more important, it can be unintentional as well as intentional. You don't have to intend it to have a racist impact, to do something racist to have a racist impact. Third level of racism, internalized racism, I define as acceptance by members of the stigmatized races of negative messages about our own abilities and intrinsic worth. Lots of ways that it can affect us, and it's really about accepting the limitations to our own full humanity of the box into which we've been placed. So now, with this background about what I describe as these three levels of racism, let's go back to the story. So here I have now two flower boxes. But what we're going to introduce is a gardener. A gardener who has two flower boxes, one which she knows to have rich fertile soil, and one which she knows to have poor rocky soil. And she has seed for the same kind of flowers, except some of the flowers are going to produce pink blossoms, and some of the flowers are going to produce red blossoms. And this gardener prefers red over pink. So what does she do? She takes the red seed and she puts it in the rich fertile soil, and she takes the pink seed and she throws it in the poor rocky soil. And 3 weeks later, she sees in her garden what I saw in mine. In that rich fertile soil, all of the seed is sprouted. The strong seed is going very tall and vigorous, but even the weak red seed has made it to a middling height. In the poor rocky soil, the weak pink seed has died. And here comes the strong pink seed, just trying to make it halfway up. And then those flowers go to seed. And the next year, the same thing happens. And then those flowers go to seed. And then year after year after year after year, the same thing happens until finally, 10 years later, the gardener is looking at her flower boxes and she says, "You know, I was right to prefer red over pink." So we're going to interrupt the story there for a minute to say that this first part of the story tells us something about institutionalized racism, where you have the initial historical insult of the separation of the seed into the two types of soil. You have the contemporary structural factors of the flower boxes keeping the soil separate, and then through inaction in the face of the perpetuation of the inequity. But okay, well, let's pick the story back up. Where is personally mediated racism in the garden? Well, now the gardener is looking at red, thinking that red is mighty beautiful. She looks over the pink flowers and she says, "Oh, they sure are scrawny and scraggly." So she plucks off the pink blossoms before they can even go to seed. Or maybe she sees that a pink seed has blown into the rich fertile soil and she plucks it out before it can establish itself, which is some of the anti-affirmative action stuff that still goes on. And where is internalized racism in the garden? Well, the red flowers are just living their lives, enjoying being red, many of them not even understanding that they're benefiting from enriched soil. The pink flowers are looking over at red, wishing with all their hearts that they too could be red. And here come the bees, minding their own business, collecting nectar, but of course pollinating at the same time. So here comes a bee, bzzz, and then up to another pink flower, bzzz, and then it comes toward this other pink flower, and that pink flower says, "Get away from me, bee. Do not bring me any of that pink pollen. I prefer the red," because the pink flower has internalized that red is better than pink. So now the question arises, what do we do to set things right in the garden? Well, let's start with addressing the internalized racism. So we can go over to the pink flowers and we can say, "Give beautiful power to the pink." And that's an important intervention. That's an important intervention. But as you can see, even if you do that, that's not going to change the situation in which they find themselves. Or maybe you say, okay, let's deal with the personally mediated racism. So let's have a conversation with the gardener. Or better yet, let's have a workplace multicultural workshop for the gardener. It's all good. So we have our workshop. And in the workshop, we say, "Dear gardener, would you please stop plucking those pink flowers?" And maybe she will, maybe she won't, right? But even if she does, it still won't change the situation in which they find themselves. I think that if we really want to set things right in the garden, we need to address the institutionalized racism, which means we have to either break down the boxes and mix up the soil, or if we want to keep separate boxes too, that's all right too, but if we do, it means that we need to enrich that poor rocky soil until it's as rich as the rich fertile soil. And when we do that, the pink flowers will flourish, could be looking beautiful, grand, and glorious as the red. And in that intervention, we might also address the internalized racism. Pink will no longer be looking over at red, thinking red is better, and wanting to be red. And in that intervention on the institutionalized racism, we also might address the personal mediated. Now, the original gardener may have to go to her grave preferring red over pink, but her children who grow up and see the flowers equally beautiful will be less likely to have that kind of attitude. So, in this story, I've actually illustrated these three levels of racism, institutionalized, personally mediated, and internalized, and very strongly suggested that if we want to set things right, we have to address the institutionalized racism. Good if we address all the levels at the same time. But the most important question is one that I haven't raised yet, and that is, who is the gardener, right? Because the gardener is the one that I gave the power to decide, the power to act, and control of resources, which in my mind are the elements of self-determination. Well, who is the gardener? The gardener clearly includes government, as well as media, as well as foundations and corporations, and even communities to the extent that they have self-determination. But whoever the gardener is, it is dangerous when the gardener is aligned with one group. I painted her red, that's why she prefers red over pink, right? And it's also dangerous when she's not concerned with equity, when she can look at her flower boxes and think that her flowers, her garden is beautiful because she's not even really keeping the pink flowers as part of her garden. And our challenge is what to do about the gardener. Do we make the gardener striped or polka dotted or fuchsia? Lots of different questions that can come out of this story. But I'm going to close in this last minute with one last image. And this image is not from my own real experience, but actually, this is taken an image taken from the book by Dr.
So we could probably listen to Dr. Jones all day, but I hope that the biggest thing you got from that is there's no such thing as post-racism, post-racial world. Okay, now that I hope that we have a good idea of how important our social, political, and economic context is to our vision of health equity, I want to discuss a few of the current Mississippi public health challenges we're facing. And these are just the ones that I saw as the biggest challenges. I'm not pushing any specific agenda other than what I see as the biggest problem. One is all these conversations that are going on around the Affordable Care Act, the potential repeal, and the renewed conversations that are currently ongoing about a new version of the Affordable Care Act and its associated Medicaid expansion or lack thereof in Mississippi. And so first I just want to describe a little bit about what Medicaid in Mississippi looks like. So first of all, as of the most recent data we have, or I was able to access in 2015, almost one in four people in Mississippi received Medicaid. About 40%, 35 to 40% of Mississippi Medicaid recipients are white, and about 55% are black. So the idea that Medicaid just serves communities of color is obviously not true. In addition, so although 67% of Medicaid enrollees are adults and children, we actually spend Medicaid expenditures, 65% of Medicaid expenditures are on the elderly and the disabled. And then among that other 35%, a large proportion of them are children. And so, you know, again, the idea that lazy adults are mooching off the system is a myth that somehow exists. In terms of funding, for about every dollar that we pay for Medicaid services, the federal government matches that for about $2.94. And without this support, the need would still be there. The health needs would still be there, and we would have to burden the cost of this. So since the implementation of the Affordable Care Act, the uninsured level in Mississippi has gone down. So the Hispanic community, 51% of the Hispanic community remains uninsured. 21% of the Black Mississippi community remains uninsured. and 16% of the white Mississippi community remains uninsured. If we had expanded Medicaid, we could have about 280,000 to 310,000 Mississippians would have gained coverage. And simultaneously, in relation to the conversations going on right now about potentially block granting Medicaid or repealing or changing the Affordable Care Act, this would disproportionately affect the low-income communities, which include the white community, and people of color who have difficulty affording any other type of protection. So the impact of expanding Medicaid in Mississippi is great. Obviously, it would reduce the number of uninsured. It would also increase provider revenue, especially to hospitals in Mississippi, which are suffering and closing down as a consequence of us not expanding Medicaid. And it would increase jobs and revenue. Another challenge that we have right now is our actual public health infrastructure. So state Department of Health agencies across the country provide basic health services. And these services include restaurant and food inspections, which, you know, include all of our schools and our hospitals. It includes providing food, providing supplemental nutrition to communities in need, which aren't only communities of color. It includes monitoring lead and water safety across our state, and Flint, Michigan is a reminder of how important that is. It includes immunizations, and we have the best immunization law in the country. While a number of states were experiencing pandemics over the past couple of years, our state health officer wasn't, and in fact, she was just fighting to continue protecting our strong immunization laws. If we have any natural disasters, we're on the front line of serving those communities. We provide first-line disease prevention and education. We also serve as a safety net system for community, a safety net primary care network for communities across the state. And without us, a lot of this wouldn't exist. And so the last fiscal year, as I'm sure a lot of us were aware of through media coverage, the State Department of Health received two rounds of budget cuts, a couple of rounds of layoffs. Programs were eliminated or reduced. People were let go, and district clinics were shut down or their hours were reduced. And this was last year in 2016. And this data that I'm showing right here compares state budget public health funding per capita. So Mississippi ranks number 47. So we're the 47th financially least supportive state of public health. We spend about $12 per person on public health. If you look at the states that neighbor us, Alabama spends $59, Arkansas $47, Tennessee $44, Louisiana $15. But even Louisiana still ranks significantly higher than we do. And this is data from 2013-2014. It doesn't take into account the budget cuts that happened to the agency last year, nor does it take into account the estimated 30% budget cut for this year. So I don't know how Dr. Currier will feel about this picture. But this Marshall Ramsey last year during the budget cuts had this cartoon and says, "Thank you for calling the Mississippi State Department of Health. We've all been laid off due to budget cuts. If you need assistance, call the legislature." I minimized the picture just in case. So the threats to Medicaid and the Affordable Care Act, the threats to our first line of public health defense, the Mississippi State Department of Health. And then if you talk to any public health professional and you ask them, what are the most important determinants of health, they'll tell you having an adequate, livable level of wage or salary, and having a good education. And if you look at Mississippi, almost 42%, and this is 2014, so there is newer data, but it hasn't significantly changed. So about 42% of Mississippians overall earn less than $25,000. That's almost half Mississippi. 62% of Black Mississippi adults earn less than $25,000, whereas half of that, about 30% of white households, live at that poverty level. 14% of Blacks earn $50,000 or more, whereas 40% of whites earn $50,000 or more. So that shows how heavy our different racial communities are in terms of being financially empowered to take control over their health. And we see similar statistics for education. About 12% of Black Mississippians have graduated college, whereas about 22% of white Mississippians have. Whereas almost 25% of Black Mississippians don't have a high school degree, whereas the percentage is significantly lower at 15% for white Mississippians. So we know the problems, but where do we go from here? So a big takeaway point that I hope people take home is people don't count if they're not counted. And what we mean by that is if we allow state-level data to mask the inequities that are boiling under the larger number, we won't know exactly who's suffering, and we'll continue assigning and dispersing whatever little resources we already have in a way that doesn't reach the people who need those resources the most. So one of my proudest accomplishments at the State Department of Health was working with Dr. Tanya Funches, who was the director of the Office of Health Disparity Elimination, to create the state's first ever Health Disparities and Inequalities Report. And it was so in demand that we republished it, reprinted it 3 times. So there's obviously a thirst out there to gain this information. Surveillance or data collection exposes disparities and inequities. It informs and guides policies, programs, and interventions, and it provides baseline measurements for evaluation so we know how much we've improved or how much we haven't improved, or even worse, how much we've gone back. And if we don't count people as they deserve to be counted, their lives effectively don't count in our collective awareness. Moreover, in counting people in their unique stories is crucial to assigning responsibility. So for example, death at the hands of uniformed officers or police with brutality is currently not a systematic federal level public health indicator. Without knowing the extent of the problem or having data to support the problem, we have a weakened argument to who should be assigned responsibility and agency to reform the problem of police brutality. So in terms of things, specific things that we can do in the public sphere, I'm biased. Kathy Burke is here. She's the president of the Public Health Association. This year, Kathy, or was it?
Last year.
So I encourage people to join the Mississippi Public Health Association in specifically or any of your favorite health issue. I'm biased towards the Mississippi Public Health Association because it's the state's largest association that monitors any threats to our public health policies and legislation. And when our director or when our president goes to the Capitol and advocates for our issues and is able to say, I represent 5,000 people, that's a lot more powerful than saying I represent 500 people. And so unifying and organizing your people in one location I find to be powerful, but you know, joining something is better than joining nothing. Again, calling or writing to your representative when legislative threats to public health and the Mississippi State Department of Health arise is important. There's example, I think a year or two ago, when the Mississippi Public Health Association, the Mississippi Medical Association, and a number of our public health and medical organizations were at the Capitol speaking to a representative about the threats to our immunization law. And so he heard our side of the argument. But the only people he heard from his constituencies were people were pro-choice activists who wanted the law changed, who wanted parents to have the choice on whether or not to immunize their kid. And so he voted for changing the law because he didn't hear otherwise. He heard from us, but at the end of the day, it's constituents that matter the most. And hearing from your constituents is arguably even more powerful than 500 people marching in Jackson. So a third way to support public health is also looking at the public health workforce. So while at the Mississippi State Department of Health last year, we established the agency's first interfaith prayer room. And as a Muslim myself, who prays 5 times a day, and I often would pray 2 to 3 of those prayers at work, and I'd often pray at my desk, and my beloved colleagues would come barging in, and it was always awkward to explain what I was doing. And so having my own private space was important to me. And so when the agency approved the prayer room, I felt respected, I felt valued, and supported in my entire being, not just as a worker. And when I got to Harvard this year, I found that my college already had an established prayer room, and not just a prayer room, but there's actually a washing ritual that Muslims do before prayer. And they actually had a bathroom specifically for Muslims with like the special unique water faucets that we use with the little stool. And when I saw that, I immediately knew that Muslims had come there before me. I wasn't the first Muslim here, and that this was a safe and welcoming space for me. And that's very important for people to fully contribute themselves and their potential to whatever community they're in. And then as a fourth way for us to contribute in the public sphere is if you're ever in a position where you're describing people, describing what Mississippians look like, or describing what people in your workplace look like, make sure that you truly describe them and don't just look at overall prevalences, but really dig in to make sure the minorities in your community are represented. So to conclude with what can we do on the individual level, and perhaps most important to me, is to seriously and heavily reflect on our responsibilities as individuals of the social contract. As much as our human self-preservation tendencies instruct us to protect ourselves, our faith, especially for those of us who take spirituality and religion seriously, commands us to protect each other. And when we are intimidated by political powers, when we attempt to be politically correct, and when we forget the social versus individual purpose of religion, we end up hurting each other in chronic and sometimes fatal ways. And any serious student of faith should understand this responsibility of religion in a very personal way so that you can never be intimidated by another woman or man. Because the mission of your life, the work of your life, if you understand religion or faith in this way, is oriented toward a much higher level of understanding of life than the relevance of any one person's political or potential power could ever be. So with that, I simply ask that we all commit to the lifelong work of being courageously bold and vocal in the face of injustice, that we not be intimidated by any person or force, regardless of who they are, how much money they are, how reputable they are. As long as we know our position is one that is oriented towards truth, and that we support each other and show up to each other's efforts towards justice-oriented work, even if you have no one to go with you and you have to go alone. And with that, I'll just leave you with these two chapters or quotes from the Quran that I recite every day during my prayers. And one comes from the chapter of Nisa', or the woman. O you who believe, stand out firmly for justice as witnesses to Allah, even as against yourselves, or your parents, or your kin, and whether it be against the rich or the poor, for Allah can best protect both. Follow not the lusts of your hearts, lest ye swerve, and if you distort justice or decline to do justice, verily Allah is well acquainted with all that you do. And then chapter 103 is called Al-Asr, which translates into the declining day, that hour right before night comes around. And it's the shortest chapter in the Quran, and a lot of scholars say that the entire Quran, the message of the entire Quran can be encapsulated in this short chapter. And it's by time, indeed mankind is in loss, except for those who have believed and done righteous deeds, and advise each other to truth, and advise each other to patience. Thank you for letting me share all of this today.
We have a few minutes for questions, and Lamise has graciously agreed to answer those questions.
And I think there's some mics here if anyone wants to use this instead.
Have you done any research, or do you know of any research about the, you know, when I was a high school student, I had to take health, and then my kids had to take it here in Mississippi, and that, there wasn't very much value in that class. It was usually given to, like, the, you know, that was like the secondary. So I just feel like that could be a real, I mean, that's something, I think the theory is that we can give some rise to a young person's awareness, but that's not working out very well. Has there been any kind of thoughts about raising the bar for those educators so that, you know, I'm paying for that education with my tax dollars, and after hearing this, I really want that to mean something to those young people.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I'm not an education expert, and the unique thing about public health is it crosses a lot of different sectors. Our work involves a lot of different disciplines, and it's actually very hard to say there's a unique public health world because we work with so many different partners. You know, what I will say is, you know, sometimes it's challenging to create these reasonably well-informed, to implement these reasonably well-informed arguments in Mississippi. You know, we still don't teach comprehensive sexual education in Mississippi. And then, you know, our education system itself needs to be reformed, not just within health classes, but across the entire spectrum. My mom is here, she's a fourth grade public school teacher in Crystal Springs. And when I first moved back to Mississippi after Hopkins, I was tutoring, I was just working as a tutor for a little bit at my mom's school, at Crystal Springs Middle School, to students who with remedial needs. And because their parents couldn't pick them up after school and the school couldn't afford transportation to take them home after school, I had to tutor within school hours or in the morning. And so the administration asked me to just choose when I wanted to take them out of class. So I would take them out of class that they were supposed to be learning in another subject. And he asked me to take them out of science or out of computer studies or out of history. All three disciplines that you need. And so, you know, and so it's hard, you know, I think it's a question that goes beyond just public health, and, you know, the experts within the education reform world need to be involved. Other questions?
Thank you, Louise. That was wonderful. In your travels around the world, what public health issues do you find are the same in Mississippi and elsewhere? And there must be lots of differences, but I'm wondering what are the ones that are the same?
Well, what's definitely the same is government plays a huge role in people's lives and whether people exist and how long they exist for and how much liberty or freedom they have to enjoy their life while they do exist. And so government, the political world is very important, and that exists in communities all across America and all across the world. Poverty is a big factor in at least Egypt where I've worked. The importance of education is also a problem. Perhaps where we differentiate ourselves a little bit is how rural we are and how, you know, we're already poor, but because we're poor and everything's distant from each other, we have to build infrastructure in a costlier way than perhaps other states would need to do because they're not as rural as we are. So poverty, education, and politics. Dr. Bauer?
Does anyone take a look at this strictly from the economic standpoint and come up with an estimate of what this would actually cost to meet your standards of equality and justice? How much money are we talking about?
Yeah. Well, if they didn't fire everyone from the State Department of Health, maybe we could hire people to do that. I'm not aware of any studies. I don't know, Kathy or Dr. Funches, if y'all are... We have two of our highest level administrators. Kathy's rolling her eyes because she doesn't want attention. But we have two of our highest level administrators from the State Department of Health here as well. But you're right, Dr. Power. You're right. That is a gap that we don't know, that I'm at least not aware of, but how much exactly that we need so that we can make our argument.
I don't know if we have we don't have a specific dollar amount, but it would help. You saw the statistics regarding how much money is put into Mississippi's public health structure. Can you compare it to the other states around the nation and just really funding public health would really help to make some changes?
Public health
question,
thank you.
Yes. It does cost money, but when we look at where we are now financially and looking at our budget specifically for this year, it's Mr. Mayor Duncan.
On that topic, I mean, looking at Alabama and Arkansas, which tend to be significantly higher than the Mississippi, outcome-wise, what do those look like compared to Mississippi as far as longevity and that disparity gap?
So all of those states do better than we do, almost by every single health indicator. They're healthier than we are. The Deep South in general has a, is that what you're asking, what our health outcomes look like?
Or yes, or just the states that do spend money. I mean, I think money is one part, but also, like you said, education, you know, all down the line.
Yeah.
So just curious, is, you know, the mortality for Black and Caucasian in those states versus Mississippi, and is there a measurable difference?
Yeah. Yeah, so, you know, there's a lot of different health outcomes that we can look at. And county health rankings and America's health rankings do a really good job of breaking down how our health looks like by very specific categories. And all of those states overall do better than us. Like, as a state, overall health indicator, they do better than us. And they do better than us by almost every single indicator. And if you look at the Deep South, in comparison to the rest of the country, we do worse according to almost every single health outcome. And then if you look at Massachusetts, for example, who invests in its people in terms of public health dollars per capita, it's one of the greatest in the country. It also has like an 84-year life expectancy or something like that, which is higher, significantly, it's almost a decade more than the US life expectancy of 75 years. So there's indication that financially investing in people's health works. And
it is evident how your faith and your religious practice both inform your work, but also keep you able to do this work in the face of some really, really disheartening information. As someone who works in religion, I also see people whose faith and religious practice can inform them to make these problems even worse than they already are. You gave us this beautiful video of this woman who has these great allegories. I'm wondering if you have any faith-oriented allegories or tools that have enabled you to operate in those spheres, knowing that the religion plays into these things in really complicated ways, allegories or metaphors or language that has enabled you to speak to people who are using their faith as a weapon rather than as a tool for healing.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do have anecdotes or tools for that, can I steal them?
I probably need a little bit more time to thoughtfully think about allegories. One that just quickly comes to mind is when the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, you know, he had just been put into this new leadership role of leading this new community of faith and convincing them this is a real religion, I'm not hallucinating. And in this very prominent and publicly visible role where people look to him, for example, there is a time when a Jewish leader's funeral procession was going by the place where he was sitting. And then the Prophet Muhammad stood up as a sign of respect to him. And then the people around him were like, why are you standing? He's Jewish, he's not, he's like, we respect all human lives. And if the leader of this new religion of the time could do that, as he's trying to convince people that this is the way to go, I don't know why you would use religion as a weapon to divide.
So one of the things I was thinking about in your response and also your presentation and the connection between the health and kind of this religious identity, I had the opportunity of sitting and talking with Reverend Barber at the Moral Mondays in North Carolina. And one of the things he talked about in the South is that we have a very conservative, you know, religious identity, but yet there are these great disparities in how there's that correlation of, you know, the importance of, establishing our identities on helping and supporting others, but yet in this deep South environment, we're not. So I don't know if it's necessarily a kind of a question, but those are the thoughts that I was thinking of, is that, you know, why is that such a disparity? We're so religious down here, but yet we're so anti-humanity.
Yeah, that's the question of the lifetime. I've truly, sincerely grappled with this question, especially in relation to Medicaid expansion, because we've become so passionate in Mississippi and in the Deep South around issues of abortion, around issues of sexual education, and when we tell people that people won't be able to see a doctor or afford a doctor, and their chance of just going to the hospital and dying on their way there because they waited so long to get treatment for this disease, and you still oppose Medicaid expansion? Especially when it's not, we earn money through this. We don't lose money, we earn money through this. So economically, logically, spiritually, healthfully, you know, every single argument is in support of this and we oppose it. And, you know, there's political reasons for this, but I'm more frustrated among just everyday people, among Mississippians, Mississippi residents who don't speak up against this, and who are too ideologically tied to their leaders to critically think about how this is unjust and how this is evil and oppose this.
What a great